Okay, welcome back to my new GN4 tutorial. So last time I have shown how to add a Cherenkov radiator to our detector geometry, which is used to create optical photons. And now in this tutorial, we will go one step further and I will show you how to add photosensors to your construction, which then can be used to detect these photons and write out the position information, for example. Yeah. So in order to do that, we have to create sensitive volumes. And this we will do in our detector construction class that we will open now. And yeah, we will start with the definition of each photosensor that we want to add. So my plan is to create an array or a matrix of 100 times 100 photosensors. Yeah, so we will get a very high granularity, which we need in order to detect the photons, the position of the photons with a sufficient resolution. Yeah, so these photosensors could be, for example, silicon PMs or MCP PMTs. So first we define each detector, how it looks like, and this should be just a simple box, so we can write again G4 box, and the name should be, for example, solid detector and new G4 box. Then as usual, first we have to give the name, which is in this case just the same, solid detector, and then we have to define the width of each of these sensors. And let's suppose we want to if we want to fill our whole mother volume surface with these sensors, then we have to write for the width 0.05 meter, which means a half width of 0.5 centimeter and the full width of 1 centimeter. And then for the length we have to do the same, 0.005 meter, and for the height we can choose any arbitrary value, but I would think that maybe 2 centimeter seems to be a good approach. So now our solid detector is basically defined, and in the next step we have to create the logical volume of our detector. But the problem here is that the sensitive volume that we define later has to refer to this logical volume. And this means that we have to access that outside of our construction function, which makes it necessary to add the definition of the logical volume to our class definition directly. So now we have to write G4 logical volume, logic detector. Yeah, and this is it. Now we can go back to our code file and write here logic detector new G4 logical volume, and then we have to do it similar to the places before, and we have to write first the solid, which means solid detector. Then we have to define the material, and I think although a detector does not contain air normally, we can just say that it consists of the world material. It doesn't matter, because the only purpose of this is to be sensitive for optical photons. Yeah. And now we can write the name, which is logical detector. Okay, and in principle, this is it. Now we can come to create the physical instances of our detector. And this is a little bit more tricky compared to what we have done before, because now we have to create an array of sensitive detectors. And for that, the easiest way, which I found, is to create two for loops. For one, we used the index I, and we start from 0 and go up to 100. And the second for loop we create inside that for loop, and we go again from 0 to 100. And now we can define our physical volume inside that second for loop, and we call it maybe first detector, and this should be new G4 PV placement. And now, as usual, we first have to add the rotation, which is 0. Maybe I can make one day another video about how to rotate a detector, but for the time being, it should be just 0. And now, for the translation, we have to think a little bit, because we want to create an array, so the x and y coordinate should depend on the index of I and j. So I can just show you how it will look like. So if you write -0.5 meter, because we want to start on the side of the world volume, plus I plus 0.5 meter divided by 100 will fulfill our purpose. And if we don't write the 0.5 here, it means half of our pixel of our detector will stay outside of the mother volume. So we have to shift it by half of its width into the mother volume so it works. You can also play around with that and change the values, and then later you will see what effect does it have. And now for the y coordinate, we have to do the same. The only difference is that we have to replace I with j. And the z component, this is also, I think it's more or less trivial, but one has to think about it, because we want to have it on the end cap of our volume. So we could in principle just write 0.5 meter. However, we have to shift it again by half of the height of the sensor back into the mother volume in negative z direction. So we have defined it as 0.01 meter as a half width. So we can write here 0.49. So 0.5 minus 0.01 is 0.49. meter. And now in principle this is everything, or the most complicated part. So now we can only define, or we have to only add the logical detector, which is logical volume, which is logic detector. Then we have to give the name first detector. Then we have to define the mother volume, and of course it will be placed inside our world volume. There's no other material around, so we can just write logic world. It should not be a boolean, so we can write again false. And we now have to define the index of each of this detector. Now, of course, the index cannot be constant anymore, as we have done it previously, like 0, but it should be also a function of the indices of our for loops. So it turns out that when you write I plus j times 100, then this is sufficient, because if j is 0, it starts basically with I is 0, or we can also write it in such a way. If I is 0, then this counts from 0 to 99, and if then in the next step I gets 1, then it starts with 100, 101, 102, and so on, and if I is equal to 2, it will start with 200, so we can make sure that by this way we have unique numbers for each detector. And this is very important, as you will see later. So now we can we can write true here, because we want at the end to also check the overlaps, whether we make any mistake, and maybe these sensors are overlapping each other. Hopefully not. So now we are ready to test our geometry and take a look how it looks like, and we can build it. Hopefully there is no mistake inside, and I guess there is one, because this should be G4V physical volume. So now we can start our script, and as you can see here, it checks the overlap for every single pixel, and it looks good. It says okay, so it means we didn't do any mistake in our calculation and there is no overlap. And this we can also confirm by looking into the geometry of our detector construction. So this is our world volume. This is our Cherenkov radiator that we have created. And then you can see on the end cap of our world volume, we find these small pixels, the small photosensors, which are very difficult to identify. I accept that, but you can believe me that these are basically correct. Maybe one can change the view, but when you do that, you can only see the full volume, which one could maybe improve also a little bit. But in any case, it looks everything worked well, so we can also create a particle going through that, and later we will detect then these optical photons with the help of these small photosensors. Okay, now in order to detect them, we have to basically define a new class as usual, and this we will do now by creating two new files, and this we will call detector.hh and detector.cc. And yeah, in the header file, we define now our class. First, we do our standard trick. And we write here class, and we call it my sensitive detector. And this should be derived from the existing class in GN4, which is called G4V sensitive detector. And yeah, we can start again with our constructor. So we just call it my sensitive detector, and the input parameter should be a G4 string. And what it means, I will explain a little bit later, but for the time being, you can just accept it as it is. Okay, so then the destructor, and now we have to write, or we have to add one function, and this is the main function of our sensitive detector, because it is needed in order to detect something or in order to process the hits, and this is the reason why it's called process hits. And here we have two parameters, G4 step and G4 touchable history. Why it's called like this, we will also see a little bit later, but for the time being, you can just copy paste it as it is. Especially the G4 step we will use now very soon. And now we have to basically use our C file and include our header file here, include detector hh. And here we have to write my sensitive detector. Basically, we just copy paste everything because it's a little bit faster. And this is our constructor, and this is our destructor. And now we come to the main part, which is the function process hits. So we have to write my sensitive detector process hits G4 step, a step, let's call it. This will be the this is the variable for each step, and then we have to write again this G4 touchable history, and this, according to the examples, I will call it RO hist. And for the time being, we will not need it, but when it is required to use it, I will then refer to that. So in principle, this should be everything. First, we have to write again CMake, because we added more files, and now we have to make it, and it gives an error. Of course, we also have to include the header file here. No, otherwise, it will not find it. And we have to make it again. Now, we have here, should be again the usual mistake which I'm making, to forget the semicolon. Of course, here this is also wrong. Here, as I said, we have to write G4 string. And what we have basically here is what it means is the name of our detector. So we have to write G4 string name, and then we have to write again G4 sensitive detector, the class from which we inherit, and we have to write here name, which is then again the name of the detector, and then we have to make it again, and now it seems to work well. So we could run it again, but I think there should be no severe error. Still, it will not show anything. And now we can go back to our construction again, and define another function here. And this is again a virtual function because it is predefined in GN4, and we have to write here virtual void construct SD, which means sensitive detectors and field. So if you would, for example, add a magnetic field or an electric field, we have to also describe it here in this function, but for the time being we will only concentrate on the sensitive detector. So we have to go now below this construction and write here void construct SD and construct SD and field. Okay, and then we have to of course include the detector file. So we have to write here include detector edge, and then we have to write here my sensitive detector, and we can just call it maybe sense that, and then sense that equal new my sensitive detector. And here, as I said, we have to write the name, so we can give any arbitrary name and just we call it sensitive detector, which is the easiest one. And now we created an object of our sensitive class, and now we have to tell our logic detector that this is our sensitive detector. So as I said, we have to now access this logic detector part, and we can write sets sensitive detector and then the name which we defined previously, sensedat. And we make it in order to make sure that everything works well. And it says that logic detector was not defined, and this might be because we have to write here, of course, my detector construction. Yeah, now it seems to work. Well, again, we can test it, but it should not change again anything. We can create our particle, and it will not give you any information until now, because we have not included anything so far into our sensitive detector part. And this we will do now finally. So what we want to get is our information about the position of our photon. So this we can do in the following. First we have to access the track of the particle. So we can write here G4 track, and we just call it track, and that we can get from this G4 step. So we can write here a step get track. Now we can get information about the track which enters our sensitive volume. And we also, when a particle enters our sensitive volume, it has a beginning and an end point. Yeah? So we can basically now define two step points. One we call pre-step point, which is taken into account when the detector is when the photon is basically entering our sensitive detector. So we call here a step get pre-step point. And the same we can do for a post-step point. In the case of the photon, this means or this will give then access to the information about the photon when it leaves our sensitive detector. In case of charged particle, it's more complicated, because every time when or after every stepping process, there will be a pre-point and a post-point. But for the time being, we concentrate only on photons, so we can remember that pre-step point means the photon enters the detector, or will be used when the photon enters the detector, and post-step point will be used when the photon leaves the detector. And we can now directly get access to the position of this photon by defining, for example, a variable which we call pos photon, and we write here pre step point get position. So now we should get the position of the photon when it enters the detector, and we can make it if I didn't make any mistake. Okay, there's an error coming from the fact that it should be G4 step point and not points. And now we run it again, and now it works. So we can now finally start our program. And if now I press on create particle track and the proton is created, and then the Cherenkov light hits our sensitive detector, we cannot see anything, because finally we have to also see out the position. So we can directly write here, okay, let's suppose we write here photon position, and then we write pos photon and G4 end line. So we can now run it again and create our proton. And now finally you see here, now I can close that, you see all the photon positions of the photons that are detected by our sensitive detector. Yeah. So these are the original positions of the photons as soon as they enter our detector. You can see that from this value 480 in Z direction, which is basically the upper surface of our detector. You can also see that sometimes it's not exactly the upper surface, but there are also different values, for example, when the photons enter from the side. So we can avoid that by basically adding the following function, which is called set track status f stop and kill. So this means that when the photon, as soon as the photon enters our detector, it is killed and the track is not propagated any further. And when you then build it, run it and create the photons, you can see that the set component is always 480, which means that they always are detected on the upper surface of our detector. Nevertheless, this kind of information we do not have in the real experiment. Now we don't have access to the real position. We only have access to the position of our detectors. Now, and from that we have to reconstruct, for example, the Cherenkov angle. So this we will not have in the reality, but we want to get access to our detector position. So we can write here const G4 V touchable, and this we can just call touchable. This is the touchable of our actual logical volume, basically. And then we have to, or the physical volume related to the logical volume. So we can write a step get pre step point get touchable, and then we can write G4 in copy number touchable, get copy number is the right function. So it means that from the actual physical volume where the photon enters, we will get now the copy number that we have defined previously in our construction, exactly here. So this is why it is important to have unique identifiers, which I said in the beginning. Okay, so now we can we have the copy number, so we can also give this out by writing CIFAR out copy number, and we can write here copy number G4 and L, and just for the time being we can test it again, and we run it, and now it should not show up the position, but it will give you the detector number that has fired. And later when you have a mapping of your detector, then you can reconstruct the position of your photon according to the copy number. But sometimes this is also not the thing which you really want, but you want the position of your detector. So you can write G4V physical volume. So now we call it just physvol, and then we get access to the physical volume. We can write touchable get volume, and then we want to get the translation of that volume. So we can write pos vector physvol get translation. Yeah, so now we get the exact position of the detector in our world volume, and then we can write c for out detector position pos detector g for end line, and the copy number we already commented out. So now again, no mistake, so we can actually run it and start our simulation. And then you can see now we have the bin structure of our detector output, yeah, which means we have now the exact position of our detector, which has been hit by a photon. Yeah, and with this, I want to stop now, because now you have learned how to insert sensitive volume, sensitive detectors, in order to continue with your analysis. And in the next video, then I will explain how to write out this information in the form of a root file and analyze this later. Okay, so I hope you enjoyed until here. You learned something. If you like it, please subscribe my channel. And as usual, stay tuned until my next video will be uploaded. And until that, see you soon.